Good afternoon, and for those of you visiting our great city, welcome to Harrisonburg. Today, we are recognizing a tremendous step in the right direction toward making Harrisonburg a city for all. The funding we are celebrating today will go a long way towards sustaining our community's access to clean water while doing so in an environmentally conscious way. So we are excited to know that Harrisonburg has Senator Warner's support as we look to continue our mission of ensuring community resiliency and protecting our national environment. Harrisonburg is a community with extraordinary beauty and an abundance of natural assets. We prioritize protection of these natural assets, air, streams, mountains, trees, and open space, critical to maintaining our quality of life and vibrant economy. Taking this action to upgrade water infrastructure is in line with our goals for Harrisonburg's sustainable future. In order to learn more about this project, I'd now like to recognize Mr. Mike Collins, the Director of Harrisonburg Public Utilities, who can speak more to the importance of the Western Raw Water Line and the work his team does every day for our community. Now, I told Mike, keep it short. That's an inside joke, right? Come on up, Mike.
Thank you, everybody. Didn't want to make it short, just a little perspective here. I want to give you some general perspective to understand this project. Want you to understand in order to understand this project, you have to understand the legacy projects that Harrisonburg's completed in the past. This project actually replicates three of our five legacy projects, only this time when we undertake it, we'll be focusing on continuity, health, and sustainability. So let me just tell you a little short history about Harrisonburg's water. In 1779, up around Court Square, Thomas Harrison deeded a little property in the spring to Harrisonburg for 100 years. That was the backbone and the foundation of Harrisonburg. But that didn't remain the legacy project. What happened was, 100 years later, City Council petitioned the Raleigh Springs Turnpike to lay a water line 10 miles to the west by pick and shovel. That was the beginning of the legacy project. 1920s, we repeated it for growth reasons. 1950s, we repeated it again for growth reasons. At that point in time, we capped out a pristine water source to the west. The 70s, we turned direction. We went to Bridgewater for the North River. Since the turn of the century, we've been looking east to the Shenandoah, all in terms of water supply. But this project here takes us back to the first three legacy projects. What will happen in this project is we will take and abandon the 1898 water line that was laid by pick and shovel and transition the 1950 water line into potable water status. We'll create a new water line that will give us the opportunity to optimize that dry river source to the west, which I'll talk about the benefits in just a moment. Matter of fact, I'll talk about them now. Three reasons. Three purposes: continuity, water quality, sustainability. From a continuity standpoint, all those customers that we've served in that turnpike land since the turn of the century, we'll be able to continue that for 50 to another 100 years. It also includes the poultry industry that exists at Hinton. The second thing is water quality. That water at Dry River is pristine. There's no human activity there. There's no industrial activity there. What that means is that our water supply in Harrisonburg will have zero risk of things like contaminant from the raw water source or byproducts from chlorine from the treatment plant. And finally, sustainability. That water comes from Dry River completely by gravity. By using that source, we'll save 2,000 to 3,500 kilowatts of electricity. For every million gallons we bring from there, we save it from using it in another source. So the opportunities here, we have engaged in that project earlier. We've came to a little bit of a standstill. to go on to other priorities. But I want to send a special thank you to City Council for their resolution of April 12, 2022 in making submittal for this application. And I want to thank Senator Warner for the financial support for this project. I think, and I hope you'll be pleased, because our goals, I think, are synonymous with yours. Number one, this is a real benefit to keep our local economy going, including the ag and poultry industry, with a special twist there. It's a relationship, a continued relationship between the city and the county with supplying our customers to the west. It's a really unique project because it has an environmental twist to it. Most projects, when you pursue raw water, are anti-environmental, and we have to worry about this. As I said, is a environmentally sensitive project from the standpoint that will mitigate electrical use in the future. And finally, we have water quality coming from there that every utility in the state would beg to have. So I hope that meets your goals. And with that, I just say, as soon as we take that check, we'll immediately re-engage in the efforts of the past. And where workers stood 125 years ago with a shovel and pick, we're going back there and we're going to repeat. I'm going to shovel and pick with modern today technology and equipment. We'll be right back at it. So I want to thank Senator Warner.
Mike did his job. And nobody talk about water like Mike Collins. Mike, I want to tell you on behalf of the City Council, thank you so much for the work that you have done and your team have done for the city of Harrisonburg. Let's give Mike another round of applause. So now before I turn the floor over to Senator Warner, let me tell you all how happy I am to know he is looking out for us in Washington. Now in his third term, Senator Warner serves as chairman of the Select Committee on Intelligence and as a member of the Senate Finance, Banking, Budget, and Rules Committee. During his time in the Senate, Senator Warner has established himself as a bipartisan leader who works across the aisles to accomplish real solutions for Virginians. He has served as a key author, a negotiator of several pieces of critical legislation aimed at rebuilding our nation's infrastructure, improving cybersecurity, restoring domestic manufacturing, protecting national security, rebounding from the COVID-19 crisis, and investing in underserved and underbanked communities. Senator Warner has been recognized as a national leader in fighting for families, hardworking Virginians, and our brave service members. Senator Warner has been a tireless advocate for our safer, stronger, more prosperous Virginia. And we in Harrisonburg can certainly vouch for that. Senator Warner, on behalf of the Harrisonburg City Council and all in our community, please let me tell you how much we appreciate everything that you, Senator Kane, and your colleagues have done to help us as we strive to make Harrisonburg the best place it can be for all who call it home. I would be remiss if I didn't take this opportunity to also thank Senator Warner as Harrisonburg moves forward on investing nearly $24 million in federal American Rescue Plan Act funds into our community. From a new fire station that will improve response time across the community, to a homeless service center that will serve people most in need in Harrisonburg, to numerous parks and recreation projects that will allow our community to come together and enjoy our great outdoors, to street improvements in our historic Northeast neighborhood, and so much more, ARPA funds are going to serve every community member in some way. We know this would not be possible without your service, and we are very excited to show you the fruit of that labor in the coming years, and many of these projects come to fruition. So, Senator Warner, we will have you back for written custard. And as always, it is a pleasure to have you here. You are a friend of Harrisonburg, Let me introduce to you Senator Mark Warner.
Thank you for that warm welcome. It is great to be back in Harrisonburg. Great to be back in the valley. Mike, I love the fact that you love water that much.
Yeah.
I did wonder when you were going back and starting to tell the story of water for the community and the county and the valley, when you started in 1789, I didn't know whether you were going to be that great. I do have a question for you. Take this money we talked about in a moment and go back and restart that process. Initially, it was originally 1898, and can I ask you why? Was Larry Rogers involved in that 1898?
He's still not free.
You know, for all of you who are young or connect with JMU, I used to come to Harrisonburg when Larry Rogers was the new young guy. Yeah. That gives you any indication of how long I've been coming as governor and senator. My apologies for being a little bit late. I can't even blame it on 81. I was with a group of folks around the Ag Bill up in Clark County. I had a lot to say, and I know and I get with some of my friends in the poultry industry after this session. Go down and talk about again the Ag Bill, which is still bipartisan, I would say. But particularly as somebody in dating myself, Madam Mayor, that I remember my first year of governor, got elected in 2001, started in 2002, and by about mid 2002, we ended up with one of the worst cases of avian flu for probably the next 20 years. So. I am one of the few senators that know about high-path and low-path avian flu, and we're going to and talk about that in a moment. Now, Mike, you stole all my good lines, but this question raw water line is really important to the community. It is really important. Call again, and it was under a certain governor, I'm not going to call which one, that when the state helped provide some resources so we could do the poultry co-op in Hinton. It's still got 500 growers and making sure we have a person involved with the local community and for our businesses is really important. So we are going to do the money shot, literally and figuratively, in a moment. But I'm going to spend one more minute and just say, and the mayor mentioned this, you know, the last couple of years, and if, depending on the TV channel you watch, you wouldn't necessarily believe this, and I say that with equal opportunity to Fox and MSNBC, but the last couple of years, you know, we've got a whole lot of stuff done in Washington, and virtually every bit of it has been bipartisan. That doesn't come out sometimes on the TV report, but it, whether it was the infrastructure bill, whether it was the CHIPS bill, whether it was the guns bill, the veterans bill, the electoral count act, and a series of others. There are group levels that are actually trying, still in Washington, to work together in what's in the best interest of our Commonwealth and our country. And one of the things that this is coming out, or these funds are coming out, is that infrastructure. And we've been talking about infrastructure reinvestment. That's really didn't matter. Who was in the White House, you know, people would say it's going to be time for infrastructure. We never got it done. But we got it done now. $55 billion actually going to go into water projects around the country. And Mike, I think this may not be the last you see of federal support. And that's going to be extraordinarily important for this project, but for future projects. I was thinking coming in, I remember when we were early on, before we passed the infrastructure bill, we were out on 81, yeah. And just looking at the bridge. You know, and I'm glad to see the construction has started there as well. And God knows, Lord knows, we've been talking about improving 81 and making it safer for 20, 30 years. We're going to see significant improvements on 81. One of the things that the mayor didn't mention,
but it is important because it is still needed in both the city and in the county. It's needed in urban areas as well as rural areas, and that's broadband. And we have, from some of the ARPA money earlier, but also there is a whole lot of additional funds coming from the Commerce Department. In fact, if we don't get 98% of all Virginians with high-speed, affordable broadband connections by 2025, it will be on us as a failure to execute, not a failure of resources. We've got more than enough resources kind of in the till to make sure that that becomes a reality. And I think we all know the post-COVID world, the notion of broadband, high-speed internet connectivity is not a nice to have. It is absolutely essential. So these funds here, they come from, you know, if we do in Washington, though, sometimes change our names. This used to be called an earmark. Now it's congressionally designated spending. And on that note, let me get everybody, and Mike, you get in the front. You're going to get every
Mike.
Come on, Mike.
Here we are, guy.
You know.
Oh, there you go.
Everybody. This one's for you.
Where are we looking, Mike? Yeah. Updated cameras here.
All right.
Thank you.
Great job. We're going to go down to the poultry meeting next. All right. Questions, comments, suggestions, criticisms? Yes, ma'am.
Hi, Virginia with the Harrisonburg Citizen, and I was just wanting to find out when construction will begin.
We don't have a schedule yet. It will depend upon if there's more information to come out about the project. So we'll do it as soon as we can. It's probably going to go, once we know all the requirements to it, we've got to go through probably 6 to 9 month year design and acquisition period, and then construction. Well, heads that ain't, I didn't get exactly where you wanted to go, but that's the best I can tell you.
Yeah, and this was Harrisonburg, you know, what they do they come to the federal office and make a list of their priorities. And this was like, the project is going to cost more than that. So, I think there's a couple of different stages.
This is a question, Jillian Lynch from the Daily News Record. This is a question for Senator Warner. Can you just speak a little bit more about how today's check presentation plays with the other topics that you're talking about in Virginia today and yesterday?
It's really important. For a long time, I think we've underinvested in our infrastructure. And some of the things when it comes to water lines, I think about some of the problems we've gotten on sewer lines, that's not very sexy. But when these water lines get this old, the potential for enormous degradation so by having these federal dollars, which oftentimes are natural state and local, it's really important. It's one of the reasons why, I know our legislature's going back in the session tomorrow. I think we have to bear in mind that COVID, God willing, was a once-in-a-lifetime experience. The federal government will probably never put as much one-time money out as it did from COVID. It was $4 billion to the Commonwealth overall, $3 billion to local governments, $2.5 billion to local schools. So one of the things I hope the legislature will consider tomorrow is how they take that state surplus and use it for long-term investments. You're never going to see, there's always an attractiveness of, let's cut this tax or cut that tax. Revenues go up and down. You're never going to have the kind of surplus dollars we've got right now. And there are plenty of long-term investments that I think will pay huge dividends over the long haul. But it's, the other money, the 81 money is coming out of the We got about $700 million plus for roads and bridges through the Commonwealth. A lot of that, the bridge reconstruction on 81 is going to come out of those funds. And the broadband stuff is all in process.
Colby Johnson, WHSB. Hey, Senator, I know we have a lot of projects that have worked, a lot of our town, we have a lot of these water lines. So the project with this scale, kind of modernizing that infrastructure, or maybe a lot of infrastructure stuff, just, I mean, how big a difference can this make for folks day to day on what the
Well, I think, again, if you look at the infrastructure, $55 billion for water projects. That is like 10x more than the other. Now, all of that is going to require, you know, you guys aren't going to pick up 100 cents on the dollar. So you've got to have a local community, you've got your state resources in. For a long time, it's sometimes those federal dollars that kick off the project. The project's been sitting on the shelf for a long time because you can't even get the design work started. It's really important. And what I think it'll mean, you know, to local communities, having access to fresh, clean, drinkable water is absolutely critical. If you're a business, having access to a good, clean water source, absolutely critical. So this is about quality of life. It's also about trying to continue to grow the economy in the valley in a way that preserves what's so special. You need to cut me off because this is about as pretty a setting. I could talk for way too long. And it's a nice enough day that you probably will listen to me more than you want to. But you know, this is a communities all across the country would die to have this kind of quality of life that you've gotten Harrisonburg and Valley. And hopefully maintaining the kind of water quality is part of that quality of life. We'll go do poultry. Thank you all. Thank you.